What's up, guys, and welcome to another version of the Sober Ways Media Podcast. I'm Jake Stambro, and I'm really excited to bring you guys what was a really good interview with ESPN lead national recruiting analyst, Paul Biancardi. Coach actually got his start in 1981 as a walk-on that got cut at Salem State University and worked his way up from 1981 to 1986 as a scholarship senior captain under head coach Tom Thibodeau, who's now the coach of the New York Knicks. So kind of a cool story there that he shared with us, as well as his time as an assistant coach at his alma mater, Suffolk University, Boston College under Jim O'Brien, where they went to an Elite Eight, Ohio State, where they went to a Final Four, and then as a head coach at Wright State, where he was there for a few years, and as an assistant under Rick Majerus, the legendary Rick Majerus, at my alma mater, St. Louis University. So some pretty cool and funny stories along the way that he shared, as well as, you know, his day-to-day operations with ESPN, you know, what he looks for in a player, what his advice is to players. So lots of great insight, lots of stuff for you guys to hear and pick up on. Book Richardson's debut will be actually tomorrow. So continued stuff that we're trying to put out there for you guys. But without further ado, let's get to this one. ESPN lead national recruiting analyst, Paul Biancardi. Ladies and gentlemen, we are thankful to be joined by ESPN lead national recruiting analyst Paul Biancardi today on the Silver Waves Media Podcast. Coach, appreciate you taking the time to come on. What's been going on? Take us through a day of Paul Biancardi right now.
Well, Jake, first of all, you got me on Friday afternoon about 5 o'clock. You're the only person I would sit down and do this with at Friday at 5 o'clock. So that's the first thing I'm doing. Second thing, watching a lot of film from events that are going on live, doing a lot of virtual evaluation, a lot of Zoom calls. Went to my first event in the last 4 months, went to a Big Shot event, which was outstanding. They did a great job with their COVID protocol and protection. And other than that, on the phone with recruits, high school coaches, club coaches, college coaches, and NBA scouts, because with the draft coming up, they want to get all their information. So I think I'm all talked out right now.
I got you. Well, Coach, you see kids every day, you know, whether it's on live stream or in person. You know, I know you're constantly taking guys in. Everyone knows, obviously, that you're looking for guys with skills and athleticism. But, you know, what's one thing that you pay attention to, you know, that you think is a big part of the evaluation process that people – may not realize?
Well, Jake, I really try to do a deep dive into the traits. We can all walk in a gym and see the talent. You can see the athleticism. You can see the skill. You can figure out the basketball IQ. But what I like to know is I like to know more about the person. The on-court traits, the off-court traits, to me, are the biggest part of the evaluation. I look at body language and coachability, you know, work ethic, all those type of attributes, intangibles. I call them traits. Because, and then off the court, I'm looking at, is he respectful? Is he kind? You know, is he giving to other people? What type of person is he off the court? What's his character? And what's his on-court character? I do a deep dive into both of those. Because in my opinion, the character can stop the player from being great. You see so many times, like I do, these highly ranked players, these high draft picks, how come they didn't make it? Wasn't their talent. It was the traits that they had. It was the ability to work, the ability to be dedicated, understanding how to sacrifice, and so many more traits that I can get into. But I try to do a thorough job with their on and off court traits. And I think that's where the evaluation becomes special.
Gotcha, gotcha. Well, I'm sure, you know, you'd agree with this. You know, one of the biggest opportunities and learning experiences for you was working under legendary head coach Rick Majerus at St. Louis, my alma mater. So one of his famous quotes is that you can tell a lot by a guy from the way that he warms up. What are some of the biggest takeaways and things you learned from your experiences with Coach Majerus?
How much time do you have? Let me just tell you this. I got a bunch of stories and I learned a lot. The one thing I'll never forget, I just tell you this up front, when I didn't work for him, when he came to my practice at Wright State, he watched practice, he took notes, and he talked to our team after. He was fantastic. He told me the next day he was going to do a clinic on the big man. And I said, well, where are your notes for that? I said, can I take a look? And he pointed to his head. He goes, the notes are right up here. He says, they're giving me an hour to talk about post play. He goes, I need 8 hours to talk about it. No notes. And that's who Rick Majerus was. He was a brilliant basketball coach. He was a very caring person to the people that were closest to him. He was very combustible at times. He could just blow up at you. And he was extremely competitive. What I learned as a coach, now, Jake, I came from 7 years in the Big East, you know, coaching against Jim Calhoun, Jim Boeheim, Rolly Massimino, Lou Carnesecca, Rick Barnes was at Providence, go on and on, John Thompson at Georgetown, then to the Big Ten with Bob Knight, and Tom Izzo was at Michigan State, and all the great coaches, Bo Ryan at Wisconsin. I thought I knew a lot about the game. I think I did. I understood a lot. I was pretty advanced in the game. When I got to be with Rick Majerus, I realized what a lousy teacher I was of the game. I might have been a pretty good coach, but I didn't know how to teach the way he did in detail. And he was so good at preparation. He always said, we're going to separate by our preparation. He would say, preparation is the separation between winning and losing. There's a great, great quote from Rick Majerus. He always wanted to be, you know, over-prepared so his teams would never underplay. He says, we can't control how we're going to play, but we can control our preparation. And he was the master of preparing for the opponent, as you know. So I learned a lot about teaching the game. I learned a great deal about scouting for opponents. Again, scouting in the Big East, Big Ten, I thought it was pretty detailed. You know, he took that preparation level and he enhanced it. The other thing was the details. Now, he would get involved in all details of recruiting, scouting, practice, games, every part of the game that was important. Now, if something wasn't important, like what color uniforms were going to wear or what music was going to be played, he could care less about things that had nothing to do with winning. The only thing he cared about was how we're going to win and where we're going to eat. Those were the two things. And if those two things were right, we were good. So I learned a lot about preparation, learned a lot about detail. And those two areas of my coaching, I think, really enhanced after being with him. Because he was a brilliant basketball mind, and I was with him 1 year, and then I got the job at ESPN. But I feel like I learned 7 years worth of information, kind of like in dog years, right? 1 year they live, 7 years they age.
Yeah, well, Coach, obviously he has you hinted on it. There's a ton of stories that you could tell him all day long. What's one funny story? Share one funny story with us that you remember that's appropriate.
That's appropriate, yes. You have to use appropriate language. Okay, every day you have to, every 7 days, right, you have to take a day off.
Sure.
So we were off on a Tuesday one time, and on the day off, we would meet in the Italian district, right, the Hill, I believe they call it in St. Louis.
Oh, yeah.
For lunch at 12 o'clock. So it's Porter Mosier, it's AT, it's Al Jensen, it's Sean Harrington, Coach Majerus, myself. And we're at a 12 o'clock working lunch. Now, needless to say, the food is just coming. You know, salads, calzones, we're at an Italian spot, pizza, pasta. And he's taking calls throughout this working lunch. We're working while he gets on the phone. We make calls or we're writing notes down. So now it's about 4:30. We're still there because we just finished dessert, because you have to have dessert when you're a coach. So we just had a 5.5-hour working lunch. And all of a sudden he looked at us and he goes, "Hey, it's 4:30. Let's go to Lorenzo's for dinner. They open at 5:00. Dinner on me."
I love
it. We just had 5.5 hours worth of food and talk, and now he wants to go eat dinner. And I had two young children. They were young at the time. And so Porter Mosier did as well. So I think Porter and I went home. Al Johnson was his right-hand guy, obviously his our grad assistant, and played for him at Utah. And I think they went out for dinner. I easily gained double-figure pounds working for Coach Majerus. But that's what he wanted to do. He wanted to talk the game or parts of the program and eat and enjoy each other's company. And I loved it. We did it quite often. But after a 5.5-hour lunch, I couldn't go to dinner.
I love the meal after the meal.
The meal after the meal. And then you know after that second meal, you had to have dessert again. Even if you didn't want it, he'd order it. And it would be on the table, and eventually you start digging in.
Well, Coach, many people don't know this, but you played under Tom Thibodeau at Salem State. You know, obviously, Coach Thibodeau has gone on to be a very successful NBA coach. What was he like back then? You know, what did you learn and take? You know, take us through that journey as a player. Obviously, your career at Salem State, and then as a coach too, through the ranks.
Well, really good story for all players that listen to this or coaches that, you know, want to talk to their players about recruiting. I'm an average high school player out of a Catholic school in Boston. And I was captain of the team because I loved to play and I had good leadership skills. But nobody recruited me out of high school. And so that really bothered me because I wanted to play, you know, D1 ball, right? We all want to play D1. Well, that wasn't happening. D2 wasn't happening. Nobody from Division III recruited me. So I decided to go to Salem State College. It was a local state university. It was affordable. And I thought maybe, you know, I'll walk on the team. Well, Tom Thibodeau was actually a senior that year that I was a freshman. And, you know, he talked about trying out for the team, coming to captain's practices. I did the whole thing. I go to tryouts. I get cut. So now life doesn't get any worse, right? You're a Division III cut walk-on. Doesn't get any lower than that. So most people would quit, but I really wanted to do this. This was my goal in life, was to play college ball. So I go back at it the second year, and I break my ankle in tryouts. So now I'm 0-2. So the third year I try out, Tom Thibodeau went from player to assistant coach. I made the team my third year as a walk-on. Fourth year, same thing. I played a fifth year because I you know, only played 2 years prior to that. So I played another year, just played 3 years. And Thibodeau was the head coach that year. He named me captain. So I go from a cut walk-on to captain over the course of 5 years. And the story behind it is that Tom Thibodeau, as the head coach, valued the work ethic, valued the leadership, valued the passion, valued being a great teammate. You know, he put a big price tag on all the traits that I talked to you about earlier. So that's why I got into the traits as an evaluator and as a recruiter, because I knew they were important. I knew they made up the person. I had limited talent on the court, but off the court, you know, my traits were in demand, so to speak. So, and then I went into coaching after that. But Tom really took my passion, which I had a great love of the game, and he elevated that love. He was, I don't want to say, well, he was kind of crazy in a good way. Good thing there weren't iPhones back then. But, you know, he used to go to all the clinics, Rick Pitino, Hubie Brown, Bob Knight, Morgan Wooten. You know, anybody he could go to a clinic, he would go. He'd go to practices on our day off. And he brought so much passion to our practice, so much knowledge. And we're a bunch of Division III guys that loved it. I mean, we would practice on game day. You know, your shoot around, we taped them up, you know, Pat Riley style. And we were notorious for being a hard-nosed team, and that's how he coached. And he coaches that way today, but I'll tell you what. You look at all the players he's coached, everybody he has coached, from someone like me who's a scrub to Jimmy Butler. I mean, he's made everyone better. He took a scrub like me and made me a better basketball player. He took Jimmy Butler coming in from junior college, unranked in high school, right? Went to Marquette, NBA All-Star. And he makes you better. You just got to love the game and you want to work. So I can't think of a better coach that I know of. Strategically, he's brilliant. Look what he did with the Celtics, right? As a defensive coach for Doc Rivers. So he goes from a Division III head coach to an assistant at Harvard. They got let go at Harvard, I believe. I'm not sure about that. Then he went into the NBA as a 17-year assistant. So actually, him and Coach Majerus met when I was coaching with Coach Majerus. They met for dinner one night. And you know, those two guys, basketball and food, they hit it off. I mean, I wish I was there. They were moving salt and pepper shakers, the ketchup, the wine bottle. Everything was moving on the table. They talked for 5 hours. They're both guys who, you know, eat, sleep, and drink basketball. And so I was very fortunate to work for Tom, and hopefully he's going to get the New York Knicks job here soon. He's one of their leading candidates. He was fabulous to play for, really hard, but that demand, he was so demanding, but he was so knowledgeable. And he was very encouraging at the same time. He encouraged all of us to be better, and he got the most out of us.
That's awesome. You coached it, you know, later on yourself. You coached in, you know, the Elite Eight at Boston College, in a Final Four at Ohio State under Jim O'Brien. You know, talk about those teams. It's something that hasn't, you know, come close to being done at Boston College since. What were some of the things that those teams had, you know, mindset, players, work ethic, et cetera, that made them different?
Well, first of all, you got to have talent to go to an Elite Eight. We had this young man by the name of Billy Curley. He was 6'10", local kid from Duxbury, McDonald's All-American. We built the team around him.
Coaches.
We had three guards. Yeah, head coach at Emerson. He's been at Ryan Silver's academic camp. So there's a plug for Ryan Silver. Yeah. And Billy was just pure in the game. Lefty, first team All Big East. You know, we built a team around him. We put three really good guards. Howard Eisley, who became a 15-year NBA player who now coaches at Michigan. Howard was on that same team with Jalen Rose and Vashawn Leonard, Southwestern High School out of Detroit. Malcolm Huckabee was a top 100 player out of Connecticut. And we found this quick little alley cat guard out of Detroit who played in the same area with Howard Eisley named Gerard Abram. Brought in four freshmen. First year in the Big East, they're 1-15. We're 1-15 in the Big East. We're getting our butt kicked every night. When we're seniors, they're going to the Elite Eight. So we built it through guys that were hungry, talented, and Jake, you'll love this, no entitlement. I mean, these guys had zero entitlement. There was no one and done at the time. If you were an NBA draft prospect, you know, you had to do it in the ACC or the Big Ten or the Big East. And back then, the Big East in the 90s was like an NBA league. Allen Iverson, Ray Allen, Kerry Kittles. I mean, Syracuse had pros all the time. So it was one of the better leagues in the country. So we built it with those guys. And you mentioned Jim O'Brien. He was the coach of the year in the Big East. And then we went on to Ohio State. He was the coach of the year in the Big Ten. We had talent there, Michael Redd and Scoonie Penn. And then a bunch of guys that bought into their role. So we did a great job evaluating players and developing players, and that's how teams are doing it today, right? Villanova, Virginia, you know, North Carolina didn't win their national championship with one-and-done guys. They did it with multiple-year guys. So you have to have some talent. You have to identify it, evaluate it, recruit it, and then build it over the course of 4 years, and you have to have a great head coach. So I worked for Rick Majerus, who – in my mind, was going into the Hall of Fame until he passed away. And then Jim O'Brien was the head Big East Coach of the Year and Big Ten Coach of the Year. So fortunate to work with those guys. And then I worked with Mike Jarvis before that at Boston U. He was Coach of the Year at Boston University. So you have to have a guy at the top who can do the job too.
Yeah, sure. talk about your job at ESPN. What's the most challenging thing for you, you know, as you go through and look at prospects and study them, get to know them, stuff like that, and ultimately doing your job? What's the most challenging thing with that?
Probably the most challenging part is trying to see everybody live multiple times. I mean, I see all the best players in the country multiple times, but I think the most challenging is if I'm in the East and then a West Coast player plays well, I'm not there. If I'm in the South and a kid from the North plays great, I can't be in multiple gyms at once. So thank goodness for Synergy. Thank goodness for Baller TV. Thank goodness for all these streaming companies, because it allows me to, when I get off the road, to go back and watch these great performances that can't be everywhere at once, I think is the most challenging job for me. And can't read what goes on in the internet and social media, because if you do that, everybody is a high major player and everybody's a Division I player and everybody's going to be an NBA draft pick. And we all know that's not true. So not being in enough places at the same time is difficult. It's just like when I go to an event, you know, there's 4 to 8 games going on at once. You can only really watch one game if you're really going to evaluate it at one time. So that's probably the biggest challenge. The rest of it is great in terms of breaking a player's strength, weaknesses down. You know, I have a bunch of categories that I use, an evaluation sheet for every player. And eventually we try to whittle it from the 1,000 Division I kids every year that come out of high school to a top 100. And we do a top 50 too by position, which helps because that puts 250 kids in the mix.
Sure, sure. Well, Coach, one last thing before we let you go, kind of a two-part question. You know, obviously you've had a lot of experiences. You know, what's one thing that you tell your younger self, looking back at all the positions you've had as a player, coach, and now with ESPN, and what's one thing you might tell, some advice you would give a player, you know, coming up through the ranks and through the recruiting process?
Okay, two great questions. You're a great interviewer, I can tell you that. You know, what I tell my younger self is this: I like who I am, I like who I was. I had some great traits, but obviously I had a lot that needed to be developed. Slow down and be a better teacher. I was so excited to be a coach. At times I skipped steps when I was my younger self as a teacher of the game. And the same thing with evaluating. You evaluate based on what you saw. And because you're going so fast as a college coach, you know, you got recruiting, you got scouting, you got practice, you've got alumni functions, you've got academic requirements for your players. I mean, you understand this, you're at SLU. There's so many different categories of your job. And sometimes you go so fast, you sometimes miss things. So I'd slow down as an evaluator and do it the way I do it now, which is very thorough. And as a coach, I try to be a better teacher. Not just trying to be a great coach and say, okay, there's that defense. What offense are we going to run? That's great. But if you can't teach kids how to get to where they have to be, coaching, I don't know if it works as well. The best coaches in the game, yeah, they get the best players, but they're also the best teachers in the game, in my opinion. And to tell the next generation of recruits or today's recruits, there's a lot I want to say to them, but the number one thing I would say is, don't play the comparison game. It's one game you're never going to win. You know, don't try to be the best of somebody else. Try to be the best version of yourself. You want to learn from other people, but you don't want to try to be like them and don't want to compare what you have to them. Again, you're always going to be better than somebody else, and somebody else is always going to be better than you. When you start to compare yourself to others, it's a recipe for unhappiness. And quite frankly, if it's the fastest way to stop your improvement and your progress as a coach, as a player, as a professional, even as a person, you got to develop you. You got to improve yourself. You don't have to prove yourself to anybody. That's the other thing. Players today don't have to prove themselves, but they do have to improve themselves. So I think that mindset of those two concepts, I think can really help a player go down the right path, because I see so many guys go down the wrong path, meaning they're thinking about the wrong things, they have the wrong approach, and it ultimately can really ruin their progress.
I love that. Don't prove yourself, improve yourself. Like
every day. And I got to remind myself every day, you know, I'd love to be Jay Billis, right? That's the comparison game. I think he's the best there is in college basketball, period. And he's a good friend of mine, but I can't compare myself to him. I can learn from him, but he is great at what he does. He's the best in our profession, hands down. And so, you know, I got to be the best Paul Biancardi I can be. And instead of trying to prove myself to the world or to scouts or to NBA people, whoever, I got to work at my craft. I got to improve myself. And when you improve yourself, Jake, that's when you impress people.
Sure. Sure. Well, Coach, I'm very happy for your success. Stay safe out there and best of luck going forward with everything that you're doing.
All right. Thank you. And Silver Waves Media for this podcast interview. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Coach. Appreciate it.